So you've been using your DNA matches to help find how some of them are related to you, and maybe you've actually found some unknown ancestors from that. It might be time now to take a look at your xDNA. And one of the things that people ask is there a corollary to the, you know, 7 centimorgan minimum that you need to have on autosomal DNA for the xDNA? Let's go over that today. Howdy, welcome to Family History Fanatics, where we love helping you climb your family tree and have fun along the way. Now, the X chromosome is a little bit different than our autosomal DNA in that if you're male, you only get an X chromosome from your mom. And if you're female, you get the exact same X chromosome that your dad has. And so there is this inheritance difference that is completely different from what autosomal DNA inheritance is like. Let's go take a look at a couple of charts to show this. First off, with males, again, males only have one X chromosome, and so that X chromosome comes from our mother. She, in turn, got X chromosomes from her father and her mother, but she only got any kind of X from 3 of her grandparents, not all 4, just 3, because her father only got an X chromosome from her grandmother. So the percentages that we see each generation are not like autosomal DNA where you see, hey, 50% to 25% to 12% on average. It actually does this little cascading effect. And as you take this chart out even further, it explodes that as far as the different amounts of DNA that you on average might have inherited from these ancestors. Now, if we look at females, well, we take that same chart and we just actually put it down one level. We get it from our mom and our dad for females, but the one from their dad only comes from their mom, but that comes from both of their dad's great-grandparents, or dad's grandparents. It always gets confusing when you start adding the greats and the grandparents in here with these many generations. But as you're looking at the percentages, you can see at that top level, 3 of those great-grandparents, on average, might have contributed 25% of the xDNA to you, and 2 of them contributed about 12.5% to you on average. But as you also have learned from autosomal DNA, those averages are just that. They're averages. They're not specifics for a single match. So let's take a look at how many ancestors we have in each generation. So for our autosomal DNA, we have the potential to have 2 ancestors, 4 ancestors in the second generation, 8 ancestors in the third, 16 in the fourth, 32 in the fifth, and right about this time, we start to see, you know, 1 or 2 of our great-great-grandparents drop off. And then 64, 128, 256, and 512 by the 9th generation. But you don't actually inherit DNA from all of those. Once we have great-grandparents, great-great-grandparents, third great-grandparents drop off, you don't actually inherit DNA from that line further back. So that is compounded then with this xDNA inheritance. We see at 4 generations ago, with our autosomal DNA, we have 16 potential ancestors that we inherited that autosomal DNA from. And that's close enough that we actually inherited DNA from all of those ancestors. Well, for males, there's actually only 5 ancestors that they could have inherited their xDNA from. And because we're only talking about one chromosome and it's only a specific length, and as I'll talk about in a second with recombination, you're not necessarily going to inherit DNA from all 5 of those ancestors. With females, they have a little bit better. They have 8 ancestors. But again, it's half the number of ancestors that you have for autosomal DNA, and they also don't necessarily inherit DNA from all 8 of those ancestors. So xDNA is tricky in this regard. Now, going on to recombination rate, if you watched a previous video of mine about the recombination rate, what I told you is that paternal recombination rate is about 1.05 recombinations per chromosome. And maternal recombination is 1.86 recombinations per chromosome. Now, only our mothers have 2 X chromosomes. Our fathers do not. So recombination does not happen in our fathers for that paternal X chromosome. Recombination can only happen for the maternal chromosome. You would think, based off of these first numbers, paternal and maternal, that The recombination rate of the X chromosome is about 1.86, very close to there. But from the data that I have gathered and others have gathered, actually what we see is that the recombination rate is less. It's only about 1.6 per chromosome. In other words, it's 15% less than what the maternal recombination rate. So the X chromosome does not recombine as often as our autosomal DNA does. So that means a couple of things. First off, remember, we have three things that can happen during the meiosis phase when eggs are being developed. In other words, when maternal chromosomes are being created. One, there can be no recombination event, and the egg receives whatever paternal chromosome is in that group. Two, there can be no recombination, and the egg receives the maternal chromosome of what is in that group. And then three, there could be a recombination that is a combination of the maternal and paternal chromosomes. So there's a percentage of time that the first one happens, there's a percentage of time the second one happens, and then of course the recombination happens. Just roughly, we can say that the first thing happens about 25 to 30% of the time, the second one happens about 25 to 30% of the time, and the last one happens about 50 to 60% of the time. What this means then is that our X chromosome is not as evenly divided up as the rest of our autosomal DNA. Really simply by the fact that there's only one chromosome. And so there's a lot less DNA to have statistics work on. So we see that xDNA segments can be passed down for several generations more than autosomal DNA. In fact, I've seen a couple of examples where a unrecombined X chromosome has been passed down at least three generations from the known people that have tested with that DNA. Well, that means that a lot of these people that you might have received that xDNA from, you didn't receive any of it from. And so because of that, our xDNA matches are not created equal. There are some good xDNA matches, and there's some not so good xDNA matches. Now, what numbers should you actually be using? When we're looking at autosomal DNA, we typically say somewhere between 7 and 10 centimorgans is really the minimum that you want to be looking at. If you're looking at much smaller than that, there's a much higher percentage, more than 50%, that it is a false segment. In other words, you might share it by chance, or the fact that you're never going to find out how you're genealogically related because that segment represents something that happened several hundred years ago where there were no genealogical records. So when we're talking about xDNA, we have this problem of this DNA isn't divided up near as much as we see with maternal chromosomes, and it can get passed down through several generations without being recombined, which all of your autosomal DNA, you might see one chromosome on your autosomal DNA that's passed down like that, but you're not going to see all 22 that are passed down like that. Statistically, it's just impossible. Before we continue, if you want to support our work, there's many ways that you can help. In the description below, there are links to our show notes, to free guides, as well as our website and blog. However, the most important thing you can do is leave a comment and share this video with your friends. We continue to grow thanks to viewers like you. So what I have usually heard is for xDNA, if it's not at least 15 centimorgans, don't even worry about looking at it. Now, if you happen to have some other matches that help correlate, that maybe you can. But just starting off, when you're looking at your matches, don't go trying to figure out where this 7 centimorgan X match person is. Now, I, in my research, have also always done something else. I really don't look at xDNA matches unless there's an autosomal match as well. Now, we know that you share DNA with all of your first cousins, and you share DNA with all of your second cousins. But once you get to the next level, second cousins once removed, or third cousins, you don't share DNA with all of them. So in other words, if you have an xDNA match, but no autosomal match, it is no closer really than a third cousin, maybe a second cousin once removed, but it's no closer than a third cousin. And it's very possible that it is 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th cousins, of which you're probably not going to find any records to actually substantiate how you're related. So I don't look at xDNA matches unless they have at least 15 centimorgans and they have an autosomal match. And frankly, that actually eliminates about 95% or so of all of my xDNA matches. So it shrinks that list down really small. And in most cases, I'm actually identifying how they're related through the autosomal match rather than the xDNA. What the xDNA tells me is that they have to be related through certain lines, as we saw from those charts, but it's not necessarily that helpful in determining how closely related they are. So if you are just getting started looking at xDNA, don't get overwhelmed with all of the small matches. Start and focus on those that you share the most xDNA with, and hopefully it's more than 15 centimorgans, but also be looking to make sure that they have an autosomal match as well. Otherwise, you could be just barking up the wrong tree. Now, if you would like to watch a video about xDNA inheritance, I have this video up here. But if you want to learn something else about DNA, then there is this video down below. I think we're going to have sneezes during the live stream today.